have here is a conference of the world's leading counter-jihadists, individual rights advocates, human rights advocates, dedicated to freedom of speech, freedom of conscience, and individual rights.
Now, I know you're not going to speak specifically about Australia, but I know you were not allowed to get into the United Kingdom last year. Is it at least a show of Australia's acceptance, the fact that you're able to come here and have these discussions and have these forums in Australia?
Well, I think it shows that Australia is a rational actor. I mean, the UK barred Robert Spencer and myself from entering because they were afraid of Muslims rioting. So, I mean, we can't be held responsible for the violent actions of others, and the fact that you're going to give in, okay, you're encouraging that kind of behavior, you're encouraging that kind of savagery and primitive behavior. The fact is, I speak for individual rights, I speak for religious minorities across the world, that's the body of my work. I never advocate for violence, ever. And so the idea that the British government said that my presence would not be conducive to the public good shows how in fear they are, that they've literally caved in to Islamic supremacism. And I think it's outrageous that I would not be allowed in, whereas radical extremist imams calling for the death of infidels are allowed into the UK on a regular basis. So it's not my failure, it's theirs.
I wasn't suggesting that it was.
Well, no, but I just wanted to clarify
that's fine,
that.
No problem. In terms of your messages around, obviously, we've got new political parties starting in Australia and what have you in this space. We actually had one standing on this platform in our most recent election. How soon do you fear, and what shape would it take if Sharia law was to infiltrate, say, Australian society?
Well, it is infiltrating. Drip, slowly but surely, the masking of the workplace, where Muslim workers demand accommodation for prayers, demand accommodation of prayer rooms. I mean, what they're doing is they're imposing Islam on the secular marketplace. In the public schools, we see the curriculums are teaching Islam. They're teaching the pillars of Islam. They're proselytizing. It's dawah in the public schools. Now, are they teaching the 1400-year history of Islam, the jihadi wars, the land appropriations, the cultural annihilations and enslavements? No. So I don't see them teaching Hinduism, I don't see them teaching Christianity, I certainly don't see them teaching Judaism. So this is how it imposes itself on the secular marketplace. And if you go online, you can see there are Muslim societies counseling parents on how to get Islam in the schools. Go to the teacher, if the teacher's not receptive, go to the principal, so on and so forth. And the very idea that we speak out against any supremacism of any kind, no special rights for special classes. The idea that it's Islamophobic, that's the term, that's the word, that's the mythical narrative. And it is mythical. It was devised as a thought-crushing device in order to silence any criticism of Islam.
Can I just make the point, Pamela, that just on that, it's nothing I've never thought of before, but in Australian schools we do teach Christianity, and we do have schools that teach Hebrew as well. So those are...
In the public school?
Yes, Christianity is certainly the principles thereof are taught in public schools in Australia.
Right.
Not all, but some.
Well, we don't have that in America.
Okay,
so that's my point of
that's
reference.
That's a good point. Okay, no, that's fair enough, because I can't expect you to be an expert on Australia straight away. On Islamophobia, do you believe that's an accurate word to describe you, given that you stand against the principles of Sharia law and a lot of what Islam stands for?
It's a false narrative. It's a dishonest premise. The fact that there have been 22,000 deadly Islamic attacks since 9/11, each one with the imprimatur of a Muslim cleric, I think it is a rational fear. I mean, we see what's happening in Nigeria on a daily basis. Christians are being slaughtered in Nigeria in the most egregious and bloodiest ways. We see Christians are being prosecuted in Central African Republic. We see it in Egypt. Look at what's happening with the cops. In Lebanon, I mean, this is happening across the world. Why is it Islamophobic to oppose oppression, subjugation, and persecution? And wouldn't Muslims that don't believe in jihad and the supremacism of the Sharia, wouldn't they be standing with me? Are they Islamophobic as well, those that don't support jihad? Are Muslims that don't support jihad Islamophobic? a legitimate question.
Do you believe that Muslims believe they're better people than non-Muslims?
Look, I don't. I look at everybody as an individual. Okay, I don't group. I'm not going to target a group. I don't do that. I have a problem with the ideology of the Sharia. But individual Muslims, to each person, I judge. I judge each person on their merit or their demerit. But I can't slap a label like that on anybody. Nor would I.
When you talk about the infiltration of, say, the schools as one example, and it's a good, you know, sort of social example, can you give us the other ones of how Sharia law and the real core principles of it can infiltrate a society, and what sort of time frame it can take?
Well, I mean, I can look at America. Okay, we see businesses like Target, Walmart are being sued because cashiers won't handle meat that's not halal. If you don't want to handle meat that's not halal, don't work at Walmart, don't work at Target. But this is how they impose Islam. They sue and they win. In Disney, a woman that worked there for a couple of years wanted to wear the hijab. Disney said, we have a dress code here since 1957. And so they designed an outfit for her, incorporating the hijab. And she said, I won't be caught dead in that costume. So she's suing. But we see this time and time again. Heinz, now, it's always companies that are very generous to their Muslim workers. Heinz, ketchup, you know Heinz, has prayer rooms, prayer rugs. Now they're being sued to stop the line for Muslim prayer times. And again, what happens is that the non-Muslims in the factory have to stop. The non-Muslims in the factory have to lengthen their day in order to accommodate the Muslim prayer times. So it's sort of in everything. I mean, look at Hollywood. Hollywood, in every single movie that they make about terrorism, it's never Islamic terror, ever. It's always Serbian terror. And even now, there's a big movie that just came out where the terrorist on the airplane, and this is a spoiler alert, is a 9/11 family member. I mean, it's the culture, it's academia, and it's the media. And they really are disarming the free world.
Can I just ask you this, Pamela? You've made it clear that you don't stand for violence, and I understand that very clearly. But there were some fears expressed today that by coming and denouncing Islam, some people could misinterpret the messages and perpetrate violence against Australian Islamic people because we have had a bit of it.
Look, that's not happening. Okay, that's not happening. This is the narrative. This is the false narrative that you and your colleagues continue to advance. The fact is, we have held rallies for the past 10 years. I had 35,000 people at Ground Zero. There was no violence. I had 10,000 people at the site of the Ground Zero Mosque. There was no violence. We've had honor killing conferences.
Sorry, I think I mean like actually at the symposium itself, but the messages that infiltrates into the community, then, you know, there can be random acts, not so much that they're going to go to 9/11.
But there's no evidence to what you're saying. I mean, it's purely speculation based on a false narrative. Anti-Semitic attacks are world record levels. In the United States, it's close to 60% of the hate crimes. And the anti-Muslim crime dropped to some like 11%. There's no substantiation. I mean, attacks against gays were higher, attacks against blacks were higher. For this obsession that the media has with the fear that Muslims are going to be attacked. Meanwhile, non-Muslims are being slaughtered across the Muslim world, and nobody's saying anything about that. We just have to worry about who might be attacked if Pamela Geller opens her mouth. It's a way of silencing critics. It's a way of shutting down the discussion. And they're very successful at it because not many people want to subject themselves to this. The smears, the libel, the defamation. I mean, it has to be a calling in order for a person to do the kind of work that we do.
Thanks for that. Well, we'll just ask you to stand there for a second, Joe. Let's get a couple of shots of us chatting. That's all right.